Throughout the years, there's been a lot of developments in spaceflight, making access to space more reliable, faster, and safer over time. However, over the last 60 years, all this development of technology has required a lot of testing. So let's talk about a few of the different vehicles designed and used for those tests. Hi! How are you here? First up, we're talking about the Little Joe. Little Joe wasn't a particular rocket, it was actually a design of rocket, and was developed to test the launch abort system for the Mercury program. Funnily enough, it wasn't actually one rocket, it was a cluster of four Sargent rockets, which were solid rocket boosters developed by the Jet Propulsion Laboratory for military use. Little Joe was created to save money and time on testing this launch abort sequence for Project Mercury. And in line with that, they actually used a boilerplate capsule on top. In the space business, boilerplate means anything that has the same size, shape, and approximate mass of the thing you're eventually going to end up finishing designing. They're often used for parachute tests after being dropped out of a helicopter or a plane as a mass simulator. And as with the case of the most recent Orion launch abort test, they actually had a boilerplate capsule that didn't even have parachutes on it. Little Joe's first test was actually a failure. The launch abort tower triggered early due to an electrical problem, and the tower and the capsule both crashed into the sea. Subsequent missions tested the abort system and capsule splashdown up to altitudes of anywhere between 15 and 85 kilometers. Along the way, they had various separation and abort system failures. However, the two missions carrying live rhesus monkeys were successful. And Little Joe's sixth and final flight in 1961 carried the first real production Mercury capsule. But it's not over, there was a sequel. The Apollo program also needed tests for its launch escape system, so they used Little Joe 2, a bigger variant, however, was still by far the smallest design of rocket in the Apollo program. It started flying in 1963, and its fourth flight had an anomaly just 2 seconds after launch, resulting in an uncontrolled roll of the craft, which then caused the whole thing to break apart due to stress. However, like any good mistake, there was still something to be learned. The launch escape system triggered as a result of the problem and carried the capsule to safety, proving that even in a situation right after liftoff, with a crazy amount of roll and a low altitude abort, it could still carry the capsule to a safe place. Now, to start talking about private space companies, we're gonna start with Armadillo Aerospace. Armadillo Aerospace was founded by John Carmack, who was a co-founder of the game studio id Software and worked on Doom and Quake and many other games. His work set the standard for rendering on modern graphics cards, and he now works as Chief Technology Officer at Oculus. Armadillo Aerospace's first vehicle was aptly named Pixel, and its job was to prove out flight control and hovering capabilities. Unfortunately, as soon as it started, Armadillo Aerospace shut down and Carmack left the project. However, its assets were then acquired by a new company called Exos Aerospace. Exos Aerospace continues to carry on Armadillo's dream with many of the same people from there, and they have a new test rocket out in the spaceport in New Mexico called Sarge. They very recently had a test flight of Sarge, which went unexpectedly sideways. However, it deployed a parachute and they were able to recover it just fine. Now they're continuing with their campaign to develop uncrewed reusable orbital launch capabilities. Next up, you can't talk about hovering rockets without talking about Masten Space Systems. With their focus on powered landing technologies, Masten Space Systems paved the way for rocket landings like SpaceX does, and are one of their main inspirations. One of the key milestones they achieved, which no one else had yet done, was an in-air engine relight. Masten went on to win the Northrop Grumman Lunar Lander Challenge, run by NASA, and actually beat out Armadillo Aerospace in that. They've since racked up over 500 suborbital reusable flights over their 5 different vehicles: the Zombie, Zoe, Zero and Zero B, and Zodiac. Their vehicles allow for a lot of research into control and landing systems, with quite a bit of Mars entry, descent, and landing work being done on their Zombie and Zodiac vehicles. Okay, it's SpaceX time. The Grasshopper was SpaceX's first hover test vehicle, operating between 2012 and 2013. It had 8 flights, going between just 2 meters up to 740 meters in altitude. Operating out of the area in McGregor, Texas, the point of Grasshopper was for SpaceX to be able to develop their control and landing technologies for the Falcon 9 rocket in order for it to be recovered and reused. After it had run its course, Grasshopper was succeeded by the F9R Dev 1 vehicle, which flew 5 flights all the way up to 1 kilometer in altitude at its maximum. But on its last flight, bad data from a blocked sensor caused it to veer off course, resulting in the flight termination system ending the mission. An F9R Dev 2 was planned. However, what's important to note is that at this point, SpaceX was starting to launch their Falcon 9 on real missions. And once they added landing legs, they actually started doing their tests during these real missions. After the first stage boosted the second stage up to space so that it could continue onto orbit, the first stage would then turn around, do a re-entry burn, and then try and land either on the water's surface or out on their drone ship. In the case of testing landing from space like that, destructive testing is kind of gonna happen. So since they were gonna throw these rockets away anyway, like everyone else had always done up to that point, it was the perfect opportunity for them to just keep throwing the problem out until they fixed it. The re-entry burns these rockets would conduct on the way into the atmosphere were actually at high altitude, resembling the kind of air pressures and speeds you'd see coming into Mars. So they gathered a lot of useful data on relighting their engines in that regime as well. As a result of this development, SpaceX now pretty much flies more reflown boosters than brand new fresh ones, which is crazy. It's not uncommon now to see one booster that's come down for its third time after its third mission, ready to be looked at and reflown. That's a big deal. It's gonna really take down the price of access to space again. Speaking of taking down the price of access to space, their next vehicle is called Starship. And to test Starship's control and hover capabilities, they have built Starhopper. Now, it may look like a rocket, except the top part has fallen off. And that's because that's exactly what happened. But if you ignore the power of weather in Texas, Starhopper is a powerful beast. At this point, after a few delays, they finally have the engine on and have actually static fired that engine with the hopper tethered to the ground. And presumably, this week is when they will have their first short little hop. The hopper itself will not be conducting hops that go particularly high. However, a short walk away, they're developing a larger orbital prototype of the Starship, which will, over the next few months, start conducting its own hop tests, going into space and coming back down at high speed to test re-entry, eventually going to orbit. A near identical one is being built in Florida currently, and we've heard that the two teams are actually competing to see who can do it fastest, but they also have to share information on how to make it that fast. So yeah, I guess they got tired of there being no space race anymore and they just made their own. So that's my list of my favorite test vehicles that I could think up off the top of my head. I know it was a bit America-centric, but trust me, this is just the ones that came to mind. If you have a particular favorite or you think that I've left one out, let me know in the comments below or send me a tweet. I'll happily read it. So I want to say this would not have been possible without my patrons. There's been a lot of changes going on over here, and you guys are nuts. Thank you ever so much. Otherwise, for the rest of you, you can subscribe. There's a bell. I think you have to press it, and then there's like an option to press all notifications, but I think they changed it again. I'm not sure. Anyway, thank you very much for watching. Have a good day. This has been Hayu. Bye.